Well, let's talk now to NATO historian, journalist and ex-reserve officer, Dr. Peter Caddick-Adams. Hello there. Very good morning to you. Thanks
Hello,
for joining us.
Yeah,
what
Hello,
do you both. Make of the present situation that clearly, as Russian forces are withdrawing, atrocities are becoming evident, and yet Russia completely denies that as fake news?
Yeah, I mean, it's a strange war, isn't it? I don't think any of us anticipated the atrocities that began to be uncovered over last weekend. And I mean, it's a horrific turn of events. It underlines why NATO is so nervous about getting involved in any shape or form. And there's all sorts of ways this conflict could leak over the borders. We've already seen a drone that crashed in Croatia. And with modern technology, it's quite difficult to contain this kind of new war. I mean, no one expected a heavy metal, intense, high-speed war of the kind that every nation was practicing for during the Cold War days. But we all thought we'd moved on and this would be cyber war and there wouldn't be a huge commitment of ground forces and tanks. And in that respect, we've gone straight back to the Cold War, if not to the Second World War, with the atrocities that we associated with the Eastern Front in the 1940s. And that's what terrifies people, that other Western nations might get sucked into this kind of, you know, unrelenting war where, you know, the Russians just don't seem in the mood to take prisoners. And do we want to inflict that on our own people? No, we don't.
So where does that leave us on the Eastern Front then? That's a term I've not heard for a while. I mean, NATO as a body is going to have to take some pretty serious action, aren't they? Whatever happens in Ukraine to shore up those border defences, surely.
Yeah, I mean, that's a very good question. So up to now, we've been pumping weapons into Ukraine to help them defend. And what's happened now, of course, with the Russian withdrawal that you've just mentioned, is they're going back to refit and re-equip and resupply and bring in lots of reinforcements. And then the campaign is going to carry on. I mean, there's no way that Russia will stop the campaign as it's been at the moment. We've got a very important date for Vladimir Putin and the Russian Federation coming up, which is the 9th of May. That's their VE Day. That's their Victory in Europe Day. And that's the day he will want to trumpet some kind of progress, some kind of victory in Ukraine. And at the moment, he hasn't got that. So between now and then, there's going to be a huge campaign away from the cities, which is where the Russians were doing badly, and in the open terrain of the Donbass. And what that means is this is going to be a different kind of war. And Ukraine now has to go over from the defensive, which is what we've been helping them doing, and they've done very well, to the offensive. And that means more weapons, more tanks, more people. And they've been training their own Federal Defense Forces, the sort of Home Guard that they've called up. But they need more weapons than we've been giving them at the moment. And it's now come to the crunch time. In order to prevail, because the Russians will just mass their forces in a very small area, Ukraine needs a lot more help than we've been giving them at the moment.
I think a lot of people are watching in absolute dismay that these awful things can happen in 2022 in a part of the world that we've always considered civilized. You're a NATO historian. A lot of people are saying, what's the point of NATO if we can't do more to stop this?
Well, I was with NATO in Bosnia, and these images exactly replicate what we saw in the Bosnian War of 25 years ago. And then NATO did go in. Not to fight, but to implement the peace accord. And that's, you know, one of the things that NATO may well be doing. One of the reasons, of course, why NATO can be so effective is half of its members, or a good chunk of them, are former Warsaw Pact countries. And they're equipped with the same kind of weapons technology that the Ukrainians are using. So this is why the Czech Republic has been able to transfer some of its old Soviet-era tanks to the Ukrainians, because that's what they use. This was why the MiG-29 saga in Poland was so appropriate, because that was the model of fighter that the Ukrainians use, and Poland had a lot of spare of. And there are other older systems locked in the arsenals of the East European countries could easily go over to Ukraine. And I think, you know, that's probably on the cards. So there's a lot of commonality there. So NATO has a very, you know, big role to play, especially when it comes to peace enforcement or peace implementation. And, you know, we don't know when that'll be, but sometime there will have to be some kind of a monitoring of wherever the status quo is. And we hope the Russians will be expelled completely from Ukraine. But we've no foresight of that.
No, as you say, it hasn't happened yet. Thank you very much for joining us this morning. That's Dr. Peter Caddick-Adams.